So it's getting recorded, right? Okay. So our first question is cracking the safe. So there is a box protected by a password, and the password is a sequence of n digits, where each of the digits can be one of the first k digits from 0 to k minus 1. While entering a password, the last n digits entered will automatically be matched against the correct password. Let's say if we have the correct password as 345, and if we type this, the last three characters will be taken for matching. And the box will open because the correct password matches the suffix of the entered password. So we are supposed to return any password of minimum length that is guaranteed to open the box at some point of it. So here is a sequence of n digits where each digit can be your first k, okay? So here, binary they have given k2, so 01 or 10, and last digit will be matched. And for
So basically they are looking for a sequence of all the numbers, right?
Yeah.
What we can form.
With correct. The two, yeah.
Okay, and k is a
number of digits.
Okay, so whatever the value of k will be, so the numbers what we are going to use, they will be from 0 to minus to k minus 1.
Yeah.
Okay. Okay, let's go through the second example also.
Yeah. So here k will be again, 0 and 1, right? 0 and 1 only we can use. So right. All the four possibilities will be held in this. 0001, 1011. If you take this string of length, right?
Okay. So when you say n equals 2, what does n really stands for?
Characters in the password.
Characters in the password. So at any time, we have to have two characters in the password for a particular.
What you return, the last n characters of that return value has to be the password, like, and the password can be formed from 0 to k minus 1 digits.
Okay, you know, can you come again please, Harshit?
So it says that whatever value you return as the output, the last n digits of that value is the password basically, and those n digits have to be formed using these 0 to k minus 1 digits.
Okay. Now to take an example in this output of example 2. So we have 00110. Okay. So in that, now when n is equal to 2, what does that mean? Does it mean like 0110?
Right. So the way I understand this is that we can have password as 00, 01, 11, or 10.
Last two.
All the combinations.
Mm-hmm.
Possible.
Yeah, that what it looks like. So, but when they say, you know, like the last n digits actually match with the password, so that was really not very clear. Because if you look at the note, in the same example, he has given a different variations also. Like you can have, the first one is understandable. You have 01100. It might be the rotated version of the output. But if you look for the second one, which starts with 1, okay, 10011. So that doesn't actually, you know, match with the output. But yeah, they are starting at a different node. Yeah, so it might be, as they say, you know, start whatever the node you start, you should end with that node, something like that, right?
So I also didn't get this question clearly. It says that we have to return the minimum length. So why are we like, why is the answer length of 5 there? I didn't understand that part. Because I will return the two digits, right? As per n, I'll return 00, 01, 10, or 11, like any of these four.
Correct.
So why is it like five characters?
I think that's because even now we don't know the correct password. But in this file end, at any point, maybe we can get the password, right? So it's like we don't know the password, and so we tried all the combinations with this file and string, and at some point we open the box.
Password, yeah.
Yeah. So that's the minimum length. With file length, I can see at some point I will open the box.
Okay. So we can. Sorry, go ahead, Archul.
So why not with length 4? Like, can you give to extend to an example? If you take length 4.
Okay, so we will take this constraints only. K equal to 1, n equal to 2. So I don't know the password, but I know that password length can be 2. So only digits I have is possibly 0 and 1. So what I can do? Maybe password can be 00 or 01 or 10 or 11. So one of this has to be the password, right?
Right.
Yeah. So what we need to do is we need to, but the thing is, first I assume maybe I tried 00. Okay. So but this may not be the password. Then what can I do? According to question, we can't create a new string. We can append it to we can append something to this one so that my last two digits can form the password 01. Okay, maybe this also may not be possible. Then what I can try? I can try is 11. Maybe this can be my password, or maybe 01. This can be my password. So at some point I will get my answer, but. This is a minimum string I can do. But if suppose let me tell you, if you don't follow this, if I say I got 0 is my first trial, I didn't get the answer. Then I tried 01 is not my password. Then I tried 10 is not my password. Then I tried 101 again, maybe I tried, it's not my password. Then I tried 1. So now in this sixth line, and I got all the possible tool and passwords. In this, one of them can be the password, but this is the shortest one.
Oh, okay. Okay, so you need to find, okay, the password is slightly making us confused in that way. So he's trying to say that you find the sequence of all the numbers, you know, of n equal to n. So they form a shortest string, right? So you have to make all the strings in such a way that you form a shortest string.
So all the possible permutations should be there. I mean, 4 will be there, right? If 2 binary digits we have. So all the 4 should be present in that minimum string.
Yeah, all the numbers, yeah. Yeah, whether you call it permutations or whatever, but yeah. Yeah. They all should be present in such a way that it is in a compressed form.
Yeah.
Okay. So that one thing is okay. I think that slightly makes sense, because but the password is actually more, you know, it's not very straightforward. It doesn't make sense there, right?
It's actually based on one called deep graph, something like that. What? Euler's path circuit.
Okay.
Can you scroll up? Where is this append? Like the way Dilip was explaining that we can only take one string.
I don't think so. It is mentioned anywhere like that. But when they say the password is a sequence of n digits, okay. So we have like n digits are like 2 digits in the first string, whatever they say, 00, 11, 00. If we take the last two 10, which is n equal to 2, something like that, you know. So somewhere we have to make sense of the whole thing.
I don't know. I mean, what
there is no relevance actually with the password. Yeah, it's just the number, the sequence of the digit equal to n, and then we have to just arrange them in such a way that it forms a very compressed version. Okay.
I was seeing one. I mean, this what is article for this word, they were explaining like, let's say two they are given, so it will one node will be zero, the other will be one. So one way, like, you can go from zero to one, so 01 will be the password, another would be like from 1 to 0. So these two possible strings are generated out of this. And if you have this, so you have four possible things, right? 00, 01, and 10, and 11, right?
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So here they were taking like they're trying to combine this with this, like what you say. If you take 00 and 0 from here, so this is one possible password can be 00.
Because first 0 and last 0 are same, right?
Yeah, yeah. Mm-hmm. And again, they were trying to get this one. They are forming a cycle actually there.
Yeah.
Actually, we didn't get much here. 0001.
Okay, now in this case, when the sequence is equal to the n equals 2, okay, yeah. He says that it's like they are the edges, right? The edges size should be 2 in this case. So where you have a 0, 0, you can form an edge, because now you can have a n equals 2, you can form actually
4.
Yeah, we can have nodes, something like that. So whose size will be of n minus 1, and they will contain all the values of k, you know, and then you can form a graph with these nodes, and then you can form edges. So you need to find those edges in such a way that you can start with from one edge and travel through all the edges and come back to the same edge, you know, and that is what you will get, a sequence.
No.
So that is what that algorithm they are talking about in the
deep solution,
right? Yeah.
But so how they are generating from this cycle? Like first they are taking, first password will be 0001, is it? I mean, one possible combination could be this, and again they are combining this with this. Then they go with this.
So actually, in this case, they take the last digit. They should match with the first digit of the next one.
Overlap,
That is what overlap is done. Yeah, go ahead, Dilip. Oh, you were saying
no, I was on the same question, but as you said, Santosh, if we check last digit with the first digit, it's two length, we can say it that way. If it is three length, then maybe we need to check two last two with last two, or last one with last one. There can be more than one combinations. We don't know which one would give us the shortest.
Well, actually, see, what I see in this case, if you look at the node section, it says n will be only from 1 to 4 and k will be 1 to 10, correct? So when you say k equals to 1 to 10, so we'll have values till only 9, right?
Yeah.
So we can always take a single digit, you know, the last single digit. Always, you know, whenever we have a number, like even if you have n equals 3 or 4, okay, so the first three digits of the n should be intact, but the last digit actually should overlap with the first digit of the next one. So it will always be the single digit, because we are only dealing with k from 1 to 10.
Okay, okay, maybe that works. But we need to find for which one to start, so that we'll cover all of them, and we can cover all of them with that way, right?
Yeah, yeah. Okay, but when you said that works, I didn't mean it. I was just thinking loud about what my thoughts were. But yeah, it looks like that. So to start with, we start with the normal one, right? 0, 0, 0. Okay, and then we start going through the whole graph and get the whole path.
Okay, Santosh.
Uh-huh.
Santosh, here for the second example, the output is 00110. So, but it has given us n equal to 2. So, for n, we have to make it as 4 combinations, right? Because here in the first example, we have n equal to 1.
which means we have two combinations of the output. For n equal to 2, we have four combinations, right?
Isn't it? No, I don't think the way I think n represents the number of digits, okay, like here n equal to 2. So you need to form a digit of size 2 in such a way that you will use a k, you know, k number of values in it, right? And then you can form all the possible sequences and then combine them. And that is what the output is going to be. It's nothing to do with n. Output is nothing to do with n. But you can use that to form a string, which will be, which you can form all the sequences, and then you can compress them in such a way they represent all the string, all the sequences. Right. So what I understand, you know, okay, I'll just write it over here. So if n equals 2, right, and k equals 2. So in this case, what I will form is, now k can be 1, 0 and 1 values only, right? So now n is equal to 2. So what values I can form from 0, 0 and 1? So I can form 1 is 0, 0, 0, 1, 1, 0, 1, 1, right? These four combinations I can form. Now I should use all these four combinations and overlap only the last digit of 1 with the first digit of 1 in such a way that I can form any of these combinations what they have shown in the output. You know, so that will be the shortest sequence of representing the whole, all the numbers. Because using this number, like if you use this 00110, I can get all these numbers, right? 00 I can get. I can get 01. I can get 11, this one. And then also I can get 10. So even if you take the other one, like 10011, so I can get 10, this one. Then I can get 00, this one. Then I can get 01, right? And then the 10. But I can get within a very short sequence.
Right?
Yeah, yeah. That is what I think, yeah.
From back to start for this particular combination, I mean, which combinations we have to pick? We have to start it from 0 or from 1?
You can start with any, because if you see the second output, what they said, they are like this guy, right? So they start with 10, but for the first one, they start with 00. So whatever the one you start, actually you come when you traverse the graph and come back to the same node, then you are good. So it's some graph algorithm. It's very specific to that algorithm. But that is what the whole, the problem statement looks like.
There's some Hamiltonian circuit they were telling to find shortest path.
Correct. But the implementation is that way easier to, but to understand why it is this way, it's very difficult, right?
Yeah.
Okay. So, anyone has any implementation want to go through that?
I tried to go through, but couldn't get much.
Okay, I will just I'll just try to share the way I went through the solution. Okay, and in the solution, whatever was there, I just converted into C++ and just tried to run that. Okay, there was one in the solution, but there are still some gray areas which I didn't understand in that solution. But okay, this was the algorithm, right? Some Herr-Holzer's algorithm which talks based on to finding an Euler path, okay? So what it says about Euler path is something that when you form a nodes, okay? So every time you form a node and you look for the in degree and out degree of a node, they should have they should be the same, right? Yeah. Sorry, go ahead.
I know, I was telling it should be equal out degree and in degree.
Yeah, equal as well as they should not be odd, something what was I was trying to look for others. And if you take this example, what they say, k is equal to 4 and n is equal to 3, you can form so many nodes out of that. And from each and every node, you can have four edges, right? So this 0, 0, you can combine with 0, 1, 2, 3, any. Because you're trying to simulate some sort of a DFS algorithm, and then you are forming all those edges. So he says that you visit each and every edge, and then actually you compact them in the form of a string. Okay, so that is what the whole algorithm is.
So I didn't get this in degree and out degree equal part.
Well, okay. So, well, let me try to explain the one which was I was looking for. I think when you're Okay, this becomes very tricky.
Okay, I can share that solution.
Yeah, please. Yeah, can you share that? I'll stop sharing. Yeah. Okay.
This one?
Yeah, can you go slightly down? Yeah, that's enough. Yeah, that's fine. Thank you. So in this, you know, okay, if we take the example n equals 2 and k equals 2. So now in this we can form only two nodes, right? One will be is n equal 2, we can form 1 and 0. Based on what the values are here, k will be 0 and 1, right? Yeah. So what we can do, we can form a graph. The graph will be like you start from node 0. The first node will be from 0 to 0, like this, right? It will be a cycle there. And then from 0, you can go to 1 dag. And then you can have another cycle from 1 to 1. And then you have another one from 1 to 0. Right. So now when you form this, you need to go through, you can start with zero and then you can go through each and every edge. So if you start from zero, you can actually start go to through this edge like zero, zero, right? Then you say this is visited and then you go from zero to one, right? In that case, you will be zero to one and you can combine that, you know, because you went from 0 to 1, so you can, because this is the same 0 you are using, so you can say 0, 0, and then you can just append 1 to add that. And then again, you go through this one, so you have completed this, then you can go through this one, so you'll have 0, 1 over here. And then again, from 1 to 0, you come back to the same node, so this will be another 0. And that is the way you form this output. Okay, so this is for n equals 2. When n equals 2, 3, it becomes more complex because you have many paths to that, right?
Santosh, one question. Why did you pick the self-edge to 0 first? Why didn't, even if you take edge from 0 to 1, will it work?
I think so, it should work. Okay, yes. Even if you go from 0 to 1, But the only thing is, you know, even if you start from one edge, like 0 to 1, and then 1 to 1, if you do, or even if you skip 1 to 1 and come, if you start from 0 to 1 like this, and then maybe you skip 1 to 1, and then you come back to 0, right? So you are missing these two edges. So you need to go back again for the unworked ones, okay, and try to form, get all those things in this one. Okay, that is what he talks about. That is some critical thing.
Okay.
So, but if you make n equals 3, it becomes a very big graph. Actually, it becomes more complex and it's slightly difficult to represent it over here. But therefore, I took a very simple one. But then I really didn't understand. Sorry, go ahead.
I'm saying that if you take n equal to 3, this would be 2 to the power 2, right?
So if you look at this, the values what they're saying n equal to 3, they will be 0, 0, 0, 1, 0, 2, 0, 3, and then they will start from 1, 0, yeah, like that. There will be many of them. So you will have so many of the nodes, you know, and then each node will have a path connected to that based on...
I don't understand, like, why are there so many? Because if you use this formula, it says that there would be this number of nodes. So if k equals to 2 and n equals to 3, so that would be 2 to the power 2, right?
Okay, so in that case, k is 4, okay? 4 raised to 2.
Okay, k is 4.
Yeah, okay, k is equal to 4, right? Yeah, so he says k equals 4 and then n equals 3. So 4 raised to 2 will be 16, right? Yeah, so you'll have all, so you'll have 16 nodes, and every time when you have a node combination, you need to have like you have to look for the last digit and first digit of each of them, and then you can form a path between each of them, edge actually.
Yeah, but it's a bit difficult, you know, to like
absolutely
come up with this, like these would be our starting nodes.
Yeah. So actually went online, I was really searching for this to really understand this, but there is some video of some guy actually, and he explains it really well, but satisfied with all those, whatever their information is there in the white, you know, but yeah, so that was it is, you know, and they say you can use the DFS, but they have modified the DFS in such a way, it's a normal DFS. But it's very small modifications. Yeah, if you can go down. Yeah, I'll just erase this for now. Okay, so. Yeah, so if you look at the DFS, so what he does is nothing, but if you look at line number 11 and 12, okay, he's starting with some node. And then what he's doing is he's actually combining a string which is from n minus 1 values and start appending all zeros. Okay, so whatever the value, that will be the first node, okay? So if n is equal to 2, you will have only single 0. If n is equal to 3, you will have 2 zeros. So that is what your starting point is. Okay, and then he puts that to the DFS on line 15 with the k value. And then when you come to the DFS implementation on line 20, it's very easy. He actually, on line number 20, he runs through all the values from 0 to k minus 1. And then he forms a neighbor. And he is using some scene which is a hash set. Or, yeah, it is a hash set over here. You actually look, it's a visited array. Okay, and then if it is not, then you add over here. But that's the only difference what he talks about in the DFS. Because usually in the DFS, you add the visited before you enter the for loop, right? Online after, before 21. But he says if you add it over here, because why we add, that is what he says in the DFS before line 21, at that point we are concerned with only the nodes visited. But when we want to have nodes, edges which are visited, you need to add it over here on line 24. Yeah, so this is very important, he says. Like if you add visited here, it means that you are actually taking care of the edges visited. And if you add the same this statement over here, it means you are taking care of the nodes which are visited. So that's a subtle difference. It's very important. And
right, because we are also taking into account the self edges, right? So if you add zero here, like if you start with zero and you add zero before the for loop, so I don't think we'll be able to incorporate zero zero.
Right, exactly. I think that makes more sense. Yeah, and that is why he's doing that. And then he's doing a normal DFS. But if you look at the answer, he's just appending the value of k every time. Okay, because you start with zero zero zero, so every time you are just going through your whatever the number of k's, yeah. So those are the only edges what you have. So you actually just append only this last digit and then you get the whole string. The implementation wise is very easy, but it's very difficult and to make sense of the whole thing. And even if you look the problem statement here about the password, it doesn't make sense. It is only the sequence what they are looking for. Correct. That is what I look for.
This is where he is prepping up for the first node, right?
Yes. Yeah. There are only a couple of things to take care of. This is the first node what he takes. He starts from 0, 0, 0. If it is n is equal to 4, right? And then he actually goes in this DFS. And there's only a small change if you make, and then we are good. And then we just have to have this answer append on line 26 when we are done with the DFS. It's like the post-order processing, he says. You actually do all that in the post-order processing. Sort of post-order, he says. It's really not a post-order. But this is the very concise form of this algorithm. But there are variations of that algorithm also people come up with, and they explained very well, saying, okay, how to take care of the self-edge without actually going through it again and again. You know, you can form some backtracking and all that. That becomes more complex to understand. But what he has represented is very easy. But if you find the variations of this algorithm, there are many different variations of it, of the same algorithm. Because you won't really, you know, it doesn't, you're not able to digest the way he says, like when you're putting on line 24, that you're taking care of, like, where you're taking care of your edge visiting, right? So that really doesn't make sense earlier also, but when now you said, Arshit, you're taking care of the self edge, yeah, then that makes sense. That is true, yeah. Okay, so I think that's the only thing. I just used this same one and implemented and just went through that. So it worked, yeah. It's Google, absolutely. So all these tricky things always are from Google.
Yeah.
Okay, there's something in the chat.
Yeah,
So I remember, like, we do DFS like this for this question, this itinerary question. So there also we were visiting all the nodes and like adding to the answer in the end.
Okay, so what is that for?
That is for like the question is like there also they have mentioned Heyerholzer's this algorithm. I mean, it just clicked me like both questions may be related. So,
oh, okay. I think that's the itinerary one, right? Okay, for that, okay. It's a little good problem. Okay.
Yeah. So when you start from JFK and like you have to make lexical traversal through all the nodes.
Oh, okay.
Like you said, right, the DFS, they are doing something different. They are adding it in the end and again removing it.
Yeah, yeah.
So,
yes, slightly similar. Yeah, got it. Yeah, no problem. Yeah, thanks for sharing, Vivek. Yeah,
next question, right?
Yeah. Yeah, if you have any questions on this one.
Yeah, or somebody wants to share something.
Okay, let's go. Yeah, let's move on.
Yeah, sure. Yeah, so our next question is like prison cells after n days. There are 8 prisons in a row and each cell is either occupied or vacant. Each day, whether the cell is occupied or vacant changes according to the following rules. If the cell has 2 adjacent neighbors, both are occupied or both are vacant, then cell becomes occupied, otherwise vacant. Note that because the prison is a row, the first and last cells in the row can't have 2 adjacent neighbors. We describe the current state of the prison in following way: cells of I equal to 1, if ith cell is occupied, else it is 0. Given the initial state, return the state of prison after n days. Okay. So here it's like on day 0, this is. Now if we see this one, mid 1, so mid one, it's both the neighbors are equal. So we are putting, I mean, for this one, it's left and right, both are same. So we are putting one. And first will always be zero and last will also be zero according to the condition, because they don't have any neighbors on both sides. Now, if you look at this zero, it's left is also same, right is also same. So one for this, left is one, right is zero. So it will be zero because it is different. Neighbors are different. Again, for this, left is this and right is one. So neighbors are different. So it will be zero. Yeah, here also left is zero and right is one. So neighbors will be zero. And again, so on, it will carry like we reach here. So, yeah.
Okay.
And yes, same thing. Same thing, it continues for the following example. And regarding the nodes, the length is fixed, is of 8. And 0 and 1 will be the values used for filling and vacant.
So now here we have from 0 to 7 days, right?
Yeah, 0 to 7 days.
So 0 is the one what is the current state what we are having as an input. And then you are actually going for 1 to 7 days. But yeah. Then when you come to day 1, actually you make the first and last cell as 0. Even though irrespective of what the value was for the input, correct?
Yeah, because of lack of neighbors on one on right side, other on left side.
Yeah. So even if we say like if there were no neighbors and then we assume that they were zeros, that doesn't work, right? Because if you look for at the end one in this case,
okay.
So if we assume that the n plus one was zero, so 0, 0, it should be one, but they are making it zero.
Can you mark it like?
Okay. So yeah. this guy, right? Okay. Just a minute. So if you look at this one, this value, the last zero value,
okay.
Correct. So, yeah. But if you look for the input here, they are showing one. And now the neighbors, this is the first neighbor, right? Okay. And the second number, if we assume something which is outside the boundary, it's also zero. They both are zero. So it should be technically one, but they are not making it one. They're explicitly making that as a zero. Right.
Yeah. According to the conditions they have mentioned, because they don't have neighbors on right. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. So that is one thing. So we just have to make it zero, whatever the values are. Yeah.
For first and last.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So that is, but then only we should take care of the internal ones. Right.
Yeah. Mid ones.
So the problem looks very easy. Okay. We just have to go for each and every day. The brute force would be like, you know, to go for n number of days. And every time you change the state, every time you take the input, you store it as its previous value and then form all the operations and create a result. And then again, use that as a input for the next day, right? So that was brute force.
Because of this, it will fail 10 raised to the power 9.
That's correct. So we have n very huge. So it won't fail, but it will be a TLE or something
TLE,
like that.
TLE. Yeah.
So then
otherwise, it's a straightforward simulation of the same whatever algorithm is saying.
Right.
Yeah.
So then the best way to optimize would be you can convert all these days, whatever the values are, the inputs in the form of a bit mask, something like that. Use just as an integer with the XOR operation, something like that. So that might add on to some optimizations, but not the complete one, correct?
Yeah.
Because you still don't take care of n equals to the larger number.
XNOR, right, or XOR?
XOR. XOR, yeah, sorry. So what would be the best way to do? Yeah. So the way I, went through some of the discussions and as a solution also, because this is also not very easy to come up with saying, when we have such a big number, what do you do? Because there are no standard algorithms or anything like that, right? So no data structure or something, but it comes to like usually when we have a limited number of prison cells, correct?
Mm-hmm.
So the state will repeat at certain point of time.
Itself, yes.
Yeah.
So how will you make sure that if you start from beginning, then it will repeat at beginning only? I mean, like it will change A to B, B to C, C to D. And again, it will repeat at beginning only. What you say?
Yeah.
It will recycle itself at the beginning. Is there any proof for that something? Or it can, at any intermediate stage also, it can
repeat
cycle kind of.
Yeah, Uday.
No, I'm just saying it can repeat after any stage.
Yeah. So if it repeats at one state, it will come back to the same, like it will be cyclic, right?
Yeah, but it can do at any intermediate also, right?
Yeah, it might be, but you will get the same state. Like if you are on zero, right? The state here, this state, okay. Right? So you come down and again, you'll have the same state somewhere here. I'm not sure which number, which day, but someday it will be, okay, maybe day 20 or so. I'm just giving an example, okay? So it might repeat in some day.
Yeah,
go ahead.
Yeah, how will it repeat? Because I think the first and last will always be turned to zeros. So I think that data would be lost just after the first iteration.
Yeah, so even I think, if it is lost, yeah. Go ahead.
Sorry. So I think we can just ignore the day zero, and like for repetition, we can only consider from day one and okay. See when the repetition starts after day one.
Yeah. So that because, should actually, we can take that as a state, right? First state. Yeah. Makes sense.
Yeah. I think someone asked like, why would it repeat, right? So if we carefully analyze this, that if you skip the last and the first one, we have six prison cells, right? And for those prison cells, we have like for each of them, we have two possibilities. Either they would be zero or one. So basically, if you try to find out the number of possible combinations, it would be 2 to the power 6.
Six, yeah.
So after we are exhausted, 64 combinations, it would again start repeating.
Okay, yeah. So, I mean, every place is capable of doing either 0 or 1. So, 2. So, 2 raised to power 6 is 64, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
The first and last will always be 0. Like, after day 0.
Makes sense.
Yeah, so if we go on, in this case, so as I think Komal also said, right, instead of taking the 0, 1, the day 0 as our initial point, we can say day one as an initial point, and then we can look for in the sequence when it is getting repeated. Okay, and so where it is getting repeated, because we need to find out the output based on n equal to 7, whatever that value is in, right? So we need to actually use that value, whatever we get the repetition value, and from that, you just remove. If it's a big number, you just take the sort of the modulo of that operation, and then whatever the number of days remaining, you just run through them.
So repetition means the entire LA will repeat, kind of, right?
Yeah. So you can use that number, whatever that repetition number, you run through all of these days, like you said. If it is repeating at 64th day. So in that case, will be like, if you divide n by 64, so that many number will have that much number of repetitions. So you just remove that, okay? And then whatever will be the remainder, you can just replace this n with the remainder. So it will be lesser than 64 operations, correct?
Yeah.
I'm just taking the example what you are discussing it, right? So that is what the whole thing comes to.
So you can use a map also, right? I mean, generate it, all those 64, keep it in a map and check what.
Yeah, to find this value, the 64 value or whatever the value is, we'll have to take help of some data structure. So yeah, map is a good example, or maybe a set also, whatever the way people prefer. So well, now one thing is, if you want to store in the map, do you store the vector of the whole day, or yeah, you can convert that also in a bit form, right? A bit mask and then store it. Yeah. Either of that. That's correct, right?
Yeah.
So I was just trying a few combinations, like few number of cells. Like for example, I was trying for 4 cells, then I was trying for 6 cells, like that. And there is one another approach. Like if we just keep ignoring the first and last cell, and if we're just considering the middle ones, then if you keep doing, then it repeats, like just ignore the first and last for always. So there, for example, for 6 cells, you'll just consider for 4, like you'll, the repetition will happen after 4 cells always.
Okay.
So if there are 4 cells, the repetition will happen after every 2 cells. I mean, after every two days.
How you get that? How did you get that? Like,
so I was just trying some like combinations. So for 4 cells, I was trying, since we have to ignore the first and the last cell always. So then it only makes sense to consider the middle numbers.
So from observation, like the one you... Yeah,
yeah, from observation.
Okay.
So from observation, like for example, let's say for 6 cells I was doing. So if for 6 cells, just ignore the first cell and the last cell. So number of remaining cells, 4. So keep doing the thing they are saying, like 0, 1, 1, 0, that thing. And then you see that at day number 4, you'll see the same combination as day number 1. Which means like whatever is the middle number of cells, like ignoring the first cell and the last cell, after that number of days, repetition happens.
Okay, that's good. Yeah. So we can converge on that, you know, and the way we can find out this repetition by using any of the data structures, or maybe you can come up with something else also, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Did you have implementation for that?
No, I did not. So.
Okay, yeah, well, this is good, yeah. Yeah, Uday?
So this was asked in one of the Leap Code Mantri challenges, and even I first thought that whether it will repeat or not. And in one of the solution, one way explained that we should try with an approach that it might repeat, but we should, in the worst case, we should try all the possibilities.
But trying all the possibilities is easy implementation, right? That's a brute force.
Yeah, straightforward.
You said that in the worst case, you might have to try all the possibilities, but you should make sure that it can be in a cycle. I mean, your solution has to take care both the ways. I mean, even we don't have the proof, right? That it will meet. I mean, what Harshit said was right, but I'm just saying it can be another problem where we might not get this intuition or proof where it will repeat.
Yeah, but in that case, it's not going to be. Is it not going to be a straightforward implementation? We just run for each and every day, okay, and just keep on doing this XORing, right?
Yeah.
So
when I solved this problem, I thought this might repeat, and I solved it in that way. Then I was not actually sure when it will repeat and resolve. Then I was trying to go through the solutions and found that if you don't know the solution, you have to write the solution that way. so that interviewer is also satisfied that it might repeat, but you have written it in a brute force way or something like that.
Oh, okay, okay. Makes sense, yeah. So that is the way you first try start with, right? So that is what you are saying. Okay, yeah, makes sense, absolutely. Yeah, so you are saying that you just go through all the days one by one and then take this input as the first day, the zero day, and then form something, some operations on as per the rules, and then convert that and take retake, change that as the input for the next day. Yeah. So, but you still need a space of one array, right? Input array, because you need to store all the values, or you can do an optimization there also in that case. So the way I was saying, like, if you want to do a day one operations, you store the day zero at some place because you don't want to change the input array. Anyway, if even if you're thinking of changing that input array, you'll have to store the values of the input at some place and then do the operations, okay, on your input array based looking at the array where you have stored. And then again, you replace that array with the input what you got from the day one. Right, Uday?
Yeah.
So, but can you reduce that also? Because they might ask, like, okay, why it's a zero of n space in that case, or whatever the zero of 8, right? It's constant though. But if it increases, then what?
Mod of.
There might be a possibility of doing that, right?
No, yeah, actually, I have written it in that way that I explained. It can go till n, but if it is below n, I will try to reduce.
Okay. Okay. Will you share your code if possible?
Yeah, sure.
Shashank, can you unshare? Yeah.
Yeah. So, so this is that A and base. So I have that set and list. So set is for detecting whether it will, whether there can be a cycle or not. And list is the one you have set, that O of N space. And I'm calculating the length of the loop as well. So that if it repeats, I can do some maths on the number of days and I can return from the list itself.
Mm-hmm.
So initially, this is the same, even it was long back. So here I was actually trying to do the same logic, whether both are there or not. So I mean, both are vacant or not. That is the XOR thing.
Right.
And one minus is just for that. If it is, I mean, one of changing it to 1 1 and 0 0. And so I'm not sure about this if condition.
That is because you are actually, you have to make 0 and n minus 1 0 always.
For the first condition, for the first iteration.
Yeah.
And since there are only 8 digits, I'm converting it to a sum, a number, and I'm storing that number in a set.
Oh, okay. Uh-huh. And that is smart. So, okay. Uh-huh.
Yeah, if the test contains that sum, there is a cycle and the hash cycle becomes true and I break out of this for loop.
Okay. Else,
I add that to the set as well as I add that list, I mean that array to that list of possible days array. And I'm incrementing the length of the loop.
Mm-hmm.
And after the loop is broken, I am checking whether hash cycle has been set or not. If it is set, I am doing that math saying that days minus 1% length of the loop and return the value at that index.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so that makes sense. That is the reason you are using least of L, the online 21.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. So how are you finding that sum in line number 36? I mean, where is that part?
Yeah, this one. I mean, it's just a, it's written, I mean, representing as a decimal number itself.
Yeah, so you, either you use a bit mask or you just do it this way. So both work, right? Yeah.
Actually, you can keep even lesser itself. Since there are only 0 and 1, you can keep 2 as well or something like that. As in, I mean, even the bit set is also possible.
Yeah, but this is much easier, right? Yeah. Instead of bit set, you'll have...
So rather than sum, you could have counted number of ones.
No, that is not possible, right? Because the number of ones can be at any positions. They can be repeated, right?
Yeah.
Can't we simply avoid this set S and use only this list L? Because if we find something again, then that is where we have to return, right?
Yeah, but we don't know the length of the loop and we don't know when it will if you try to check it in the loop itself, it will be off and right.
If you take this as a set, then I think it will be fine.
No, I think set you can't avoid, but the max you can do is you can avoid this least L whatever is taking, but you will have to do another iteration at the end. If you find the whatever the length, yeah,
you can convert that sum into sum back into the array.
Yeah, so maybe something like that, but it might be more of a time and complexity, a bit of increase in that. But yeah, you can argue both of the conditions. You know, I think this is a very good way of implementing, because you have taken care of each and every case. You have taken care of the cycle. You have taken care of there is no cycle also. Correct. Yeah.
And good thing is this solution works for any length, like 8 or 10 or 5. I think it works.
Yeah. At least the length. You mean to say the number of days?
No, I mean the length of the array.
The length of
we have 8 length, right?
Yeah, he is actually looking for, it will run for any number of arrays, any length of arrays, correct.
No, actually, the digit, here I am, it's a decimal number itself, so it can be any digits.
That thing, if you change, maybe it works for any, other logic works for any length.
Yeah.
But then if max you can go for long, maybe 64, then only something. Yeah, but still the number will be huge, right? Yeah.
But people also trying to convert that 0 1s to a string and storing in hashmap, so we can do that for them.
Yeah, string is also possible, yeah.
We can actually convert those 0 1s to the number and store it in an integer.
I think that is what he did, right? As Uday. Uday did the same thing. Yeah.
Okay.
I think he's saying is converting to decimal number. Is that?
Yes. I mean, convert that to 0000, 0001 is 1, and 101 is 5.
Oh, okay. Uh-huh. Yeah. Convert the binary into a decimal. Yep, that's good. Yeah, thanks Uday, thanks for sharing it.
I have used just one hash map only.
Go ahead. Let him share, Shashan.
As soon as I find it again, sorry, not hash map, vector of vector.
Okay, uh-huh.
if I finding it again, then I'm returning this like n modulo of size.
Okay.
So this is that part where I'm like setting the next for the next day. Like if if these are equal, then it would be one. This temp of I would be one. And if I haven't seen this temp before in my vector of vector, I'm pushing the temp. And for the next day, I am initializing this, like res equals to temp. And okay, if I find it again, like if I see that temp again, so I'm returning this.
So you are actually pushing whatever that
that entire vector,
pushing the entire vector. Okay, the temp, whatever you have actually transformed that day, state you are pushing in your scene, and whenever you find that at the start, because you are actually maintaining those number of the way he did, Uday did, instead of using a list, you are using the same array vector, and then you are just appending to it because they will form a sequence. Okay, yeah, makes sense. But then when you end at that point, okay, then you go and look for that. Okay, yeah. It is exactly the same implementation, right? Then what he has done.
I'm getting a bit confused.
No, it is right, you know. Because see what you are doing here in your line 8 to 9, you are creating, you are transforming to the next state, correct? Okay.
Yeah.
And then when you come to line 11, you are doing, what you are trying to do is, forget about line 11 for now, but you look for line 12, you are just pushing that day. Okay. So that you are trying to have a complete sequence. Okay. So whenever you see a sequence repeat, then you'll come to line 11. Okay, because the front portion of that, the front element of that array will have that value because it will be repetition, right? So at that, immediately at that time, you're just going to go inside that array and then you're going to form that scene size. Okay, yeah. So that is what your size is now. And then you just go do a modulo that is as if that you are finding the remainder of n in that case.
Yeah.
And then you're returning. Yeah. This also is almost the same. Yeah.
What is being done at line number 9, res of I minus 1?
So this is like, if this is true, like if both of them are same, then this would be 1.
Okay. Yeah. No, it makes sense. If it is pure. So it's actually comparing like equal. I mean, that is the point where you are checking whether it's repeating or not.
Yeah, this is where I'm checking.
Then,
this is where I'm forming that vector.
Yeah.
I'm starting from 1 and like going till 6 because the first two will always be 0. In it, by default, it takes a 0 only. Temp.
Yeah.
And so, neighboring elements, it's checking if they are same, then true it will be.
Yeah.
Because
1, it will check 0 and 2.
Yeah.
Because the default temp will be initialized to zeros, so he doesn't have to even take care of 0 and n minus 1.
Last
one. Yeah, this is also good. Sorry. Yeah, Uday.
It's a very short one, yeah.
Sorry?
Here day one can be part of the loop. Will work. Day one is part of that loop. If it tries to form a loop in between, then this. Initially when Shashank was asking whether it can repeat intermediate or at the start, right?
Yeah.
So if it is here, the first one can repeat. If the first one cannot be part of that loop, then this might not work. We have to use it.
But for this problem statement, it will repeat, right?
Here it will repeat,
yeah. If it doesn't repeat, then we'll have to find a different way to implement. Yeah, makes sense. Yeah.
to stop sharing.
Yeah, he is.
Yeah. So somebody wants to share or what?
No, I, so Harshi, that's some question.
Yeah, so I'm not able to stop this. I don't know why. Can you do it, Shashank?
Yeah, he is come actually. He is sharing it now.
Yeah, I'm sharing it.
Okay.
So this is like the longest univalue path. So binary tree is given. We have to find the length of longest path where each of the node in the path will have the same value, and this may or may not pass to the root. And length of the path between two nodes is represented by number of edges. So you're like this, sorry, 5, 5, 5. So there are two edges from 5 to 5 and 5 to 5. And in this case, 4, this subtree, triple 4. So from 4 to 4 and then 4 to 2 are there. And given binary tree will not have more than 10k nodes, and height of tree is not more than 1k. Yeah. So yeah, how to proceed?
So what is the input? Input is going to be a tree node, which will have the whole tree like this, right?
Structure, yeah.
And then, so we have to go through the whole tree and then find out what are the repetitions of the node values, and they should be consecutive also, right? Whatever the path they are, like they can be root to any leaf or leaf to leaf by some middle root also, not including the main root, can be some other node. Right. Mm-hmm. So if you look at example 2, can you just bit scroll down, please, Shashank?
Sure.
In this case, we have 4, 4, 4, where 4, 4 are leaves, and the next 4 is a parent of those two leaves. So you can have any ways. And then you have to and then you have to return the number of edges which connect these all nodes, right?
Yeah, so distance between the two extreme nodes, right?
I think they are talking about the edges, right? They are not talking about the distance.
So, I mean, so in second example, you are taking this 4, 4 only, no?
Right.
So distance between the left node and right node is 2 only. Like, whatever will be the edges, that will be the only distance, no?
Right. But, yeah, that is also other way of saying. But, if you look at the problem statement, can we just re-verify what maybe, the length of path. Okay, sorry.
Yeah, length of the path.
It is the same, what you're saying, and the number of edges between them. Yeah.
Distance.
Yeah, that's good. That's right. Then it's the length or maybe the number of edges, both the same.
Number of edges.
So we had a similar problem, right? Somewhere in lead code only, where we had to look for the sum of maximum node values or something like that.
Yeah,
it was similar to this problem. But whenever we get any of these binary tree problems, even they look very easy, but they are not so easy because you have recursion.
Yeah.
And when you try to implement them, you come up with many challenges. That is what I've seen.
Yeah, recursion makes it a bit...
If you can do it in an iterative way, that will be good. But that will take more implementation, right?
More lines of code will be there, yeah. This is more crisp recursion, yeah.
Correct. Okay, now to go with this one, how do we count? Okay, on a high level, if you just think of it, how do? We just go through each and every node. Okay, if we do a recursive way, maybe whatever the traversal we follow, in order, post order, pre order, whatever it is. And then whenever we come, maybe if it's like a pre order, we look for whatever the value is. And then we try to compare the values of its leaves. Okay, and then just add them. Maybe something like that. Or comparing with some global variable.
At every stage, you'll have to pass the previous value to compare with the mixed.
Okay.
Right.
Yeah.
Or you can start from leaf also, post order traversal kind of. From leaf you keep on popping up. I mean, go up and keep on seeing that if they are matching. And try both the left and right. Because there could be more paths, like one subtree is like 4, 4, 4. If the root is also 4, mm-hmm. and extreme, this is also 4, and this is also 4, then this would have been the, bigger path, right? Oh, from yes. Extreme left to extreme right.
Okay, so in the same one, just can you hold, I'll just annotate, you know, if you have some different example, like, you know, this one, this is also 4, okay, mm-hmm. and my, this is also 4, and this is 5, the way it is. So, yeah. What will my answer be? 1, 2, 3, and also this one, 4? So, is it going to, okay. So it's just going to count the longest one.
Longest one, yeah. 1, 2, 3, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, so then it is easy though. The problem is also E bucket. So you are saying that you always go through the root and then compare whether the left and right are same and then you add them, something like that. But what if the left and right, in this case, you know, when you come here, right, in this position, your right tree is not same as your 4 number, right? So, and if we have a big tree below that also, then what do you reset that answer in this case? Or, okay, if it's a, I'm just thinking.
Oh, you're telling from 5, we have another subtree, right?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, we'll have to reset only, you know, because we lost the previous connection, right?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, maybe if it depends, like if the subtree that you have formed, if that contains a 5 and that becomes the largest node, then.
Okay. Yeah. So similar, like the way we do for max so far, we just store that value. So this value, whatever we have, this 3 value will store in some max so far value. And then we start with the fresh current with whatever that value 5. And then you go on from that. Okay.
Keep on updating. Yes.
Yep.
Yeah. Somebody wants to share some implementation.
I think let's go with yours. Yeah.
So this is the global variable that I've defined, longest unique path. So it's a helper function. So if the node itself is 0, then I mean no, not there is no node, then return 0.
Mm-hmm.
Or I'm going to the post order traversal. This is left and right first. I'm going extreme left, I'll go from here 1 to 4 to 4, I'll go, and then similarly for right, and I'll check if node dot left exists and node dot left value is equal to node dot well, right? If this 4 matches with this 4,
okay.
Yeah, if we are at this node, then we'll check whether the root value matches with the left child or not. So if it is that, then on the left path, I'll increase by 1, and the other way around. Like if this matches with your this, then on the right path, I'll increase by 1. And just, keep on updating, I mean, initial, this is your longest path, The variable that I've taken, and now you'll add your, whatever path you have obtained on left side and right side. That you will add and check which one of them is maximum, because that is the distance between two nodes, right? A root is there, root to left and root to right. So extreme left and extreme right, what is the, when you add them, that will be the distance between those two.
Okay, but now when you're on line 24 and 27, when you are adding 1 to both of them,
yeah.
So is it not you are adding the node values, because you are actually incrementing whenever you see node equals, right? So will that not be the node values? It should be the edge value, right?
Yeah, it's an edge value. I mean, to that I'm adding. You're telling that to the 4 we are adding value.
Okay, if you are adding edge. Okay, because your path of left and path of right, initially they might be some value like 0, the way you are returning. Yeah, on the top.
Yeah.
Yeah. Because if you take an example of this two, if you start traversing, we'll come to the last 1 year, right?
Okay. So
then you'll have those two values 0, 0.
Mm-hmm.
And then on line number 20 and 21, you'll return 0, 0s. Okay.
Yes.
And then you come up in this case, you know, backtrack, something like that.
Then from left, you'll return 1.
Yeah. Okay. That is the reason you will be adding 1. Because you are having all 0, 0s value, and then you will.
And from right also, you will return 1.
Yeah. Okay.
So you go 2, yeah. And so.
Yeah.
It's like off and only, like post order traversal. First, I'm going from bottom, and then popping up, not popping, going upwards, up direction.
Yeah.
But Shashank, if you are checking while going towards the leaf, okay. Maybe that would decrease the complexity, right? If it doesn't match it, then we won't go to that subtree or that set. That subtree.
So you are trying to say from top to bottom?
Yeah, from root when you're moving, if your root value is equal to the child value, then only you call it. Otherwise, you don't call it. So maybe for the branch, for the paths where it won't match, you don't need to call them.
But same I can do from here also, right? If I go from bottom to top, the moment I find that my left value doesn't match.
You already traversed the whole tree and went to the leaf. Then anyway, you're coming back. You already visited all the nodes.
All the nodes. Yeah, that makes sense. I'm doing 2 times traversal, right? First, I'm going from top, like the extreme bottom, and then again, completely. Yeah, that should.
So, Dilip, the way you are saying on line 20, you can modify that, right? You can say if left node dot left and node dot left value and node dot value is same, then only you go to line 20, okay. Right?
Yeah.
You call it with incrementing count, the length, something, and it, when the leaf, when you reach the leaf, or when it doesn't match to the child, you return that value.
But then how do you initialize that value? Because it has to be initialized to 0 at least, right? When you return it back. Okay. Anyway, you will initialize it outside the if loop.
Yeah.
Makes sense.
Do you have that implementation?
No. I just thought maybe okay, from
your optimization. Right. Yeah. That makes sense.
But I was saying, if they don't match, also you need to visit that. You need to visit it. Still, you need to visit the subtree, right? Because the longest path can be in that subtree. That you.
Yeah, that's true.
Yeah. Oh,
it may not be, that's a catch point, like may not be like it will pass to the root.
Because we are not considering the leaf actually. Okay, based on the node value we should not is restrict. I agree there. Because you might miss some other value which is different than this.
Like the one you said 5 will have again subtree, maybe there could be the largest one.
That is what I'm saying. You know, whenever you come to a binary tree, the things are very tricky. You never know. You know, you keep doing it, everything looks good, and then there is some test case which actually spoils the whole thing. Yeah, you have to be very careful. It's so always better to have all the standard implementations very well
optimized.
Yeah, optimization is very tricky. So be very careful when you're optimizing binary trees. Though it looks very easy, implementation-wise, but it's not so easy. So be careful then. Yeah, good.
So it will take order of n only, like visiting all the nodes only once. But order of n only, right? Order of n, like visiting the nodes.
Yeah, I think we can take it as once only because we are returning back from that. In a recursion way, but we are visiting once.
Yeah, only once. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. Oh, well,
we are going to left and again, then comparing nodes. So it's not twice.
No, it's not twice.
Okay.
That is what I think. Yeah. Because you're going down always. The only thing you're doing some processing on the post part, right? Post processing.
Yeah.
That's only the difference.
One operation and then here. Yeah.
So one doubt I have, like in line number 31, you are calculating this longest underscore path. But why aren't you taking part of scattered path?
Your voice is breaking, right?
Yeah, so is it kind of...
Your voice is breaking, Harshit.
Hello.
I think what Harshit tries to say is why we are adding left to UNI plus right UNI. Is that Harshit?
Yeah, that is the distance.
No, no. Am I audible now?
Yeah, now you're better.
Yes.
So I'm saying that why are you not including part of left and part of right while finding this longest UNI path in line of.
Yeah, I mean, including this, no, left of UNI plus right UNI. I mean, if you go to this subtree, I'm adding this distance, right distance plus left distance.
No, he is saying that why are you not using path of left and path of right, those two variables? Instead of that, you are using left of UNI and right of UNI.
So I'm storing it in this, I mean, assigning to this, adding value to this and assigning this value to the left UNI. I could have used that also, no problem.
No, you won't be able to use that, right? Because you are actually updating. Oh, he's saying that you use that itself, okay. Instead of having another variable, you can use the same variable adding, incrementing.
Exactly.
Okay. Yeah. That makes sense.
But just to make it more clear, I wrote it like different here.
But you need to return the max at line 33, right? Either left or right, you need to return.
I think what Harshit was saying, that path of left and path of right, those two values only if you increase, and then you use the same variables instead of adding two new variables, right? Right, Harshit, that is what you're trying to say?
No, I was saying that, like, don't you think these two variables also should be part of the maximum, like you should also take them into account while finding longest uni path on line number 31?
Like, yeah, so I'm sure
these two, longest uni path and... Yeah, go on.
No, I was saying I mean increasing the path and storing it in a different variable, and that variable I'm using. So it's one and the same thing, right? Either I write the name of that same variable over there and use it, or a different one.
I think he's saying it's something different.
No.
Okay.
So these two variables, 24 and line number 27, these would be initialized only if you have a root value same as your left and right, right?
Yeah.
So otherwise they would be zero, like either of them or both of them.
Hmm.
So let's say we get both of them as zero. So you are not including part of left and part of right while finding your longest uni path on line number 31. Right. So
you are saying that earlier information is lost. That is what you are saying.
No, it's not lost, but I think you are not using it to finding the maximum, or maybe it's been taken care of in the previous recursion stack.
Yeah, it will be there in that with recursion. But either it will be zero or it will have some value, right? So if it is zero and your longest unit path is already greater than zero, then it's good to ignore them, right? So you will keep on building on that because that's a max so far till now, right? On length 31.
Longest, yeah.
So whatever the value you have.
Yeah, so these two answers, part of left and part of right, they have already been taken care of in their own recursive calls, right? I mean,
yes.
If they are eligible to be just part of answer.
Yep.
Yeah. Because the way I was doing, I was maintaining a class where I was having three variables. Left answer, right answer, and other would be answer including the root. So, I mean, it's more or less the same, but it's more, my code is more complicated, and I mean.
Okay. We can go through that. Before that, okay, just 1 minute. Uday had some question on the line number 33. Let's go through that and then go to Harshit.
No. I'm actually referring to what Harshit was saying. It was not a doubt, actually.
Okay.
Yeah. So I'm having very poor net connection.
Yeah, no problem. Yeah, we can quickly go through your code also, Harshit.
Yeah. No, it's not entirely working right now.
Okay.
Hello. Yeah.
Yeah.
It's not working.
Okay. Okay then.